The 15th of December 1950, Bombay. The death of Sardar Patel. For over 30 years, he fought and worked for freedom, for the unity and well-being of his people.
There have been born leaders, and there have been leaders by chance, by wealth, and by luck. This peasant patriot was a leader by merit. His life was a gospel of devotion, determination, defiance, and dauntlessness. Diligence was his choice, discipline his creed.
On one of his birthdays, Vallabhbhai Patel said,
"I am extremely touched by the affection that you have shown. I have said things, some of which may be harsh, but however bitter they may be, they are a perfect dose of medicine that I give you."
Vallabhbhai was born in 1875. He went to the primary school at Karamsad and learnt the three R's. After finishing school at Nadiad, he burnt the midnight oil to make something of himself. He eventually became a lawyer after studying with borrowed books. His daughter, Maniben, recalls that although he wanted to go to England himself, he stood down in favor of his elder brother, Vitthalbhai. Indeed, he paid his brother's expenses with the money he had saved for his own trip. While he was pleading for a man accused of murder, Vallabhbhai received a telegram informing him of his wife's death. He put the telegram in his pocket and continued with the case. In his own words, "One life is gone, let me save another." The man was acquitted. When his brother returned from England, it was time for Vallabhbhai to go. While he was in London, another lawyer, M.K. Gandhi, in South Africa, was questioning the moral basis of the existence of man in the 20th century. Vallabhbhai returned to India in 1913 and set up practice in Ahmedabad. He was utterly unconcerned with the political activities of the Indian leaders. Then came Gandhi. In 1915, Gandhi addressed members of the Gujarat Club. Vallabhbhai Patel, barrister at law, was playing bridge at the club. He refused to listen to what to him was a lot of idealistic hot air and continued with his game. But then an odd thing happened. In 1918, a devastating flood had destroyed 75% of the total crop of Khera district in Gujarat, but the government was adamant in collection of taxes. Then Gandhi decided to launch a satyagraha. In that situation, Vallabhbhai realized that Gandhi was a man of action. He gave up his practice and volunteered to work for the cause. In the words of Gandhi, "If Vallabhbhai had not been with me, the satyagraha would not have succeeded." In 1919, Britain enacted the infamous Rowlatt Act, which provided for arrest and trial without due process of law. Gandhi appealed to the entire nation to demonstrate peacefully against this violation of fundamental rights. At Jallianwala Bagh in Amritsar, without any provocation, troops opened fire on a peaceful crowd, killing and wounding hundreds of men, women and children. The freedom movement was now intensified. In 1920, Gandhi gave a call for a countrywide non-cooperation movement and boycott of all foreign goods. The spinning wheel became the symbol of the struggle for freedom. Like many other congressmen, Vallabhbhai now began to wear homespun khadi. Carrying of the Congress flag was banned by the British in Nagpur. Vitthalbhai and Vallabhbhai went to Nagpur and led the flag satyagraha, which was a roaring success. It was a bad decade for the farmer. The 20s saw falling prices and diminishing returns. The Raj, however, was implacable in its demand for increased revenue. The poor peasants of Bardoli petitioned government for relief. Their imploration met the proverbial deaf ear. But there was one person willing to listen, Vallabhbhai Patel. He organized the Bardoli Satyagraha after having warned the people that they must be prepared to make sacrifices. Thousands of villagers volunteered to follow him. Many of them went to jail. In spite of intimidation, in spite of confiscation of land, of cattle, and even pots and pans, the peasants stood by Vallabhbhai's leadership in this satyagraha. Drums would warn the people, and officials would arrive to find deserted streets and closed doors. For 9 months, a tense nation watched this dramatic war of attrition. In the words of K.M. Munshi,
it was a great experience for me when I saw Sardar leading the 80,000 Bardoli peasants into a grim struggle of limitless courage.
The movement was successful. The government reverted to the old revenue rates and ordered an inquiry. It was from the time of the Bardoli Satyagraha that Vallabhbhai Patel came to be known as the Sardar, the leader. He traveled to various parts of the country and took up the cause of the farmer. Mahatma Gandhi now had a brilliant array of lieutenants. In 1928, the All-British Simon Commission came to India to recommend constitutional changes. The exclusion of Indians in a matter so important infuriated the nation. The Congress decided to boycott the commission. In a peaceful demonstration, Lala Lajpat Rai, the Lion of Punjab, was brutally beaten and he died of his injuries. All of India was grieved and indignant. The will to freedom was strengthened. As the midnight hour of 1929 passed into history and 1930 was being born, the Lahore Congress resolved to fight for complete independence. When the demand for complete independence fell on deaf ears, Gandhi decided to break the salt law as a symbolic act of defiance. So Sardar Patel was given the task of going over the route of the march from Ahmedabad to Dandi to enlighten the people. He was arrested at Ras and thrown into Sabarmati prison. He missed Gandhi's epic march to Dandi. In 1931, Sardar Patel was elected president of the Karachi Congress. In that year, Gandhi went to London to attend the Round Table Conference. It was a failure. At home, repression against the peasants was intensified. On his return, both Guru and Chela were sent to Yeravda jail. When he heard that government was selling off the Bardoli ashram, Vallabhbhai humorously said, "I suppose it's a fair exchange. After all, we've taken possession of their jail." Although he retained his sense of humor, Sardar Patel was now a sick man. During his detention, he had lost his beloved mother and elder brother Vitthalbhai. In 1936, the Congress decided to contest the elections to the provincial legislatures. Sardar Patel was chairman of the subcommittee to select candidates. The Congress came to power in 10 provinces, thus showing that it had an abiding place in the hearts of the people. When Britain declared war on Germany, the Viceroy dragged India into the war by issuing an ordinance without consulting any Indian leaders. The Congress wanted to support Britain on one condition, that if the war was being fought for democracy and freedom, that freedom should extend to India at the end of the war. The Secretary of State loftily said that India must first show her fitness for dominion status. All the Congress ministries resigned, and leaders called upon the people not to support Britain's war effort. As the Japanese approached the Indian border in 1942, Roosevelt prevailed upon Churchill to seek a solution to the Indian problem. Sir Stafford Cripps brought to India proposals for an interim government, vaguely promising independence at an unspecified time in the future. The Congress flatly rejected these proposals, designed to continue Britain's imperial stranglehold on India. On the 8th of August 1942, the now famous Quit India Resolution was passed by the Congress in Bombay. Speaking on the resolution, Sardar Patel said that India could not tolerate slavery anymore. Mahatma Gandhi clarified the Indian stand. "Our quarrel is not with the British people. We fight their policies." The very same night, all national leaders were arrested. Sardar Patel was among those taken to the Ahmednagar fort. The British could and did physically lock up Mahatma Gandhi and his colleagues, but not their ideas. An apparently leaderless nation continued Gandhi's non-violent war. Reprisals followed. More than 1,000 people were shot dead and more than 3,000 grievously injured. Over 100,000 people went to jail. Never in history had there been mass civil disobedience on such a scale. When the war in Europe ended, all national leaders were released. they were invited to Simla by the Viceroy, Lord Wavell, to discuss constitutional changes. Unfortunately, the parleys broke down because of differences between the Congress and the Muslim League. But events were moving fast. When Japan surrendered, the Labour government announced that elections to central and provincial legislatures would be held. The Congress won an overwhelming majority in the Central Assembly and in 8 provinces. A cabinet mission composed of Lord Pethick Lawrence, Sir Stafford Cripps and Mr. A.V. Alexander came to negotiate an agreement for the transfer of power. The agreement had to be acceptable to all political parties. The bitter rift between the Muslim League and the Congress could not be bridged. The cabinet mission proposed its own solution. A constituent assembly came into being and an interim government was formed, headed by Jawaharlal Nehru. Sardar Patel was in charge of home affairs and information and broadcasting. Eventually, the Muslim League joined the interim government with Liaquat Ali Khan in charge of finance. But the Muslim League continued to agitate for the creation of Pakistan. There were communal riots all over the country. Partition became inevitable. Lord Mountbatten was the new viceroy. It was decided by all the parties concerned that transfer of power would take place on August the 15th, 1947, to 2 independent dominions. In independent India's first government, Sardar Patel became the Home Minister. He was faced with a tremendous law and order problem and the problem of millions of refugees escaping from Pakistan. In his own words,
"Let us get on with the job in the hope that we will do it well and the faith that despite the shock which the whole organization has received from the recent disturbances, we shall acquit ourselves creditably in one of the great rescue projects of history."
Sardar Patel now set out to integrate over 500 princely states into the Indian Union.
लेकिन ये छोटे-छोटे जो वाड़े हैं उससे बहुत नुकसान होता है और जिस चीज से मुल्क को फायदा नहीं होता है इस चीज से आकर
All our hearts should be filled with the thought of a united India. After centuries, we have the freedom to forge a unified nation. The integration of princely states was perhaps the greatest achievement in the life of Sardar Patel. The assassination of the Mahatma was a blow to every Indian, but especially to those who were close to him. Grieved as he was, Sardar urged the people of India not to shed tears.
Oh.